And so with Adrian's presentation as sort of an introduction to the whole session with the outlining of some of the theoretical goals that we wish to shoot towards, we're now going to switch gears a little bit and take a more chronological perspective through time, starting with the Lower Paleolithic and ending in the Holocene. And the first one of these talks is by Akash Srinivas, and take it away.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I'll be looking at motu technologies in both Western Europe and South Asia, and looking at how variability can be assessed through expanding criteria. So for example, as Dr. Berg pointed out, we have various approaches to lithic analysis. Each have their own set of parameters, classifications, and technological attributions. And for the longest time until recently, and in case of South Asia, even into the present, we still apply typological criterion such as the presence or absence of hand axes, LCTs, or even the quantities of retouched flake elements in technological attribution. And also another point which Dr. Berg emphasized is that it's impossible to take terminologies defined in, say, a typological paradigm and approach it and apply it on a technological paradigm. So in order to, get over these biases, which unfortunately underestimate variability in assemblages, because unfortunately we don't have the toolkit to look at variability in lithic assemblages on different resolutions, be it at within the site, between sites, between regions, or through time, and also functions. And the most controversial bit, culture. So I will touch upon this in the discussion. So in order to get through all of this, I decided to look at two assemblages, one from Western Europe, that's Isaniel Apineta, and one from South Asia, that's Mahadev Pipriya. And both of these were selected because they are controversial in their technological attributions. So with regards to Isernia, I think some of you might be familiar with it. It was discovered in 1978 during the construction of the Napoli-Vastro highway, and it was identified as a paleontological site and assigned the Isernia Lapineta faunal unit. It's located in the upper Volturno basin, and the site is located in quaternary alluviums with intercalated tufts and travertine, which is the bedrock. Recent dates have put the entire unit 3, which is the archaeological layer, at around 586,000. And those who've applied a more morphological or typological approach have assigned a mode 1 classification because of the absence of LCTs as well as the low incidences of retouched flake tools. But with expanding criterion, using technological and chain of repertoire analysis as well as behavioral traits, other workers have called it a mode 2 assemblage. With regards to Mahadev Pipriya, it was discovered in 1961 by Dr. Khatri during his doctoral dissertation fieldwork, and it's located in the central Narmada Valley. It's a few kilometers upstream of Hathnora, which is the site of the only hominid fossil in the subcontinent of the Pleistocene. And it's located in a setting where it's mostly Acheulean or Mutu techno-complexes. It's an open-air site in a cemented gravel conglomerate on the left bank of the river, which means it is primarily a secondary context site, but we'll think of that. Unfortunately, there are no dates, be it absolute or relative, so that's something we need to address. Khatri, who did the initial work, classified it as a Mahadevian industry and called it a pebble tool complex, pebble tool and flake, which can be equated to a mode 1 terminology, because in this time period, you have multiple uses of multiple terminologies. You have the European terminology of lower, middle, and upper Paleolithic, as well as the African terminology of early Stone Age, middle Stone Age, late Stone Age, as well as indigenous applications of something called the Series 1, Series 2, as well as cultural nomenclatures like Mahadevian for the lower Paleolithic or Nevasian for the middle Paleolithic. So there is no standardization in terminology, which is something we are addressing currently in the subcontinent. And in 63 and 65, another doctoral candidate, Supekar, conducted excavations at this site. He said it's a mixed assemblage comprising of three different traditions, although it's coming from the same stratification, the criteria he used was typological. So he said all the pebble cores and flakes belong to a chopper chopping tradition, all the bifaces belong to an Acheulean tradition, and those that were on siliceous material was a Middle Stone Age element. So this kind of classification is problematic. So that's one other reason why we went to Madhya, because this most people who work on South Asia assume that this is one of the classic Mode 1 sites in the subcontinent, which might not be true. So the methods applied primarily is lithic analysis, looking at 1704 artifacts from unit 3S69 of Isernia, only the flint elements, as well as 121 elements from Madhyapipriya. The discrepancy I'll get to in the next slide. Data collection included traditional flake and core attribution, flake and core measurements, and analyzed using technological, chain of repertoire, statistical, and attribution following these parameters. So for Isernia and Madhyapipriya, I used Barsky, Dalotia Pareto, and Mosquera, which is a European standardized terminology, a comparative database, so as not to regionally or make it Eurocentric in terms of the Indian assemblage. I also applied Clark and Klandest from Africa and Shea's mode terminology from the Middle East. So with regards to distribution in Isernia, we can see that around 139 elements are core elements, around 1100 are flake elements, and you also have naphtoclast and debris. One interesting find is the fact that we could identify the first evidence of fastenage on flint at the site. With regards to the collections, distribution of collections from Madhyapipriya, three collections were looked at: the original Khatri collection, of which only half of it could be recovered. There's a more recent Patnaik collection also from surface. So Khatri and Patnaik collections were from the surface. And the Patnaik collection was done in late 2000s. The Supikar collection is from both excavated contexts, I told you, excavation 63 and 65, as well as surface collections. Unfortunately, when we visited the repository, out of the 1300 artifacts, only 78 could be recovered. Nobody knows where the rest are. And the 78 were fortunately recovered because they were in another site, not even labeled Madhyapipriya. So that's why we have this giant discrepancy, and unfortunately that is going to bias this study. So we'll deal with that too. So going back to Supikar's thesis, this is the distribution of the artifacts. Out of the 1300 artifacts, 860 are what he assigned to the early Stone Age. Again, this is because he separated quartzite materials from silicate materials and considered everything to be from quartzite to be early Stone Age, and those that are from chert or other silicates as Middle Stone Age, which is problematic. So we have LCTs as well as other core tools, as well as flake and core components. And characterizing the nature of the lithic assemblage at Isernia, focusing on the flint material, it's locally available in three faces. One is aphanitic without any microcrystals in it. Then we have microbrecciated and macrobrecciated. We see there's a bit of selection towards aphanitic and microbrecciated varieties over the macrobrecciated varieties. And the blanks are usually tabular and tabular slabs, because the nature of the cleavage of the raw material ensures that it breaks down in that form. Surface is patinated with some evidence of abrasion, and as I previously stated, the distribution includes cores, flakes, debris, naphtoclast, and one shaped artifact. Two techniques of percussion were noted: a direct handle percussion as well as bipolar and anvil percussion. And three methods of flaking were identified, the dominant being the opportunistic, followed by the centripetal, and then the discoid. With regards to the bipolar and anvil percussion, it is applied in two stages, either as the primary technique, as in the case of this core, wherein the core blank is exploited only using the bipolar and anvil technique, or as a secondary technique, wherein a core is previously exploited using some other strategy, in this case unidirectional longitudinal, and later in the final stage before discard, it is subjected to bipolar and anvil. It is interpreted as means of trying to maximize raw material exploitation from the poor black. Like I said, there's one reported or confirmed evidence of fastenars on flint. It doesn't look beautiful, it doesn't look pretty, but there is bifacial removal on an aphanitic slab, and this is the largest clast in the entire assemblage. It's almost two times bigger than the others, other clasts in the assemblage, and this is very similar to some of the bifaces found in Guada San Nicola, which is a Motu site in the vicinity. Also, to ensure that it's not a core, or it could be a core that's also used, we subjected to microscopic analysis and found three zones of utilization, which Dr. Gabriel Beruti, who's a microscope and an expert in Ferrara, he said is indicative of anthropogenic use, intentional anthropogenic use. With Isernia, you also have another sequence using limestone, which is also locally available. Mostly again as blocks because it's coming from the bedrock, and again it's patinated, and this includes only cores, flakes, core tools, and debris. So there are no fascinoids in this, and it's only exploited using a direct hard ammo percussion and only with opportunistic method. With Mahadev Pipriya, we see that it's coarse-grained quartzites, coarse and medium-grained quartzites, as well as cryptocrystalline silicates, which is locally available from the stream bed. That's the dominant blank morphology, and there is evidence of rolling as well as calcrean on the artifacts. Its coarse flakes, core tools, and bifaces are what the assemblage is composed of, and it also indicates two techniques of percussion and three methods of flaking, with the opportunistic being the most dominant, followed by the discoid, and finally the centripetal. Here too, the bipolar anvil is applied in two forms, in forms of cobble opening, wherein the pebbles and cobbles are smashed open to access a platform, and also in terms of flaking it, as for depth touch. This is some bifaces. You have a cleaver, that's A, and two crude bifaces, or two bifaces made from cobbles from the site. So the reconstructed reduction sequence at Isernia is that you have the angular glass, which are used as cores, subjected to two forms of percussion to get flakes, some of which are retouched, some of which are utilized. Both the cores and the angular glass were sometimes subjected to retouch, secondary flaking, or utilization as core tools, and with one example of biface. The waste resulting from the entire sequence was sometimes utilized, which somewhat mirrors Mahadev Pipriya, wherein you have water-worn pebbles, which are either selected for a natural breakage or subjected to bipolar and anvil to split the cobble, which serves as a course, which is then subjected to two forms of percussion to get flakes, which is retouched and or utilized. We have both the cobbles themselves as well as the course after splitting that are subjected to work, further work, before used as core tools, or bifacially shaped as bifaces. Again, waste recovered is sometimes utilized. So we see that raw material for both the cases are available locally, and there is some selection criteria that's applied. The bipolar anvil was highlighted because, according to Barsky, it's something that is an innovative technological adaptation to deal with region-specific external impact factors. The quality of raw material in case of Isernia, and the clast size in case of Mahadev Pipriya. So cores are exploited minimalistically with the minimal core preparation, and also discarded after a few removals. There is also evidence of core management because of discoid and centripetal cores, and it's primarily geared towards flake bank production. Flakes are detached using multiple strategies, and with evidence of secondary working both on flakes as cores as well as blanks for flake tools, and there is evidence of fascination. So applying the European criterion, we see there are similarities between both Isernia and Mahadev Pipriya in terms of Mosquera, Galotti Pareto, and Barsky, indicating that it is most probably a mode 2 assemblage, techno-complex. Using Clark and Kalandice for Mahadev Pipriya, also a similar mode 2 ascription, and following Shea is also mode 2. So in conclusion, we can say that there is mode 2 in both Mahadev Pipriya as well as Isernia, which is similar to other contemporaneous sites in the region, and elsewhere, and technological variability within the mode 2 encompasses a wide range, including assemblages that could pass off as mode 1 criterion if simple criterion such as presence, absence of bifaces and LCTs are recorded. So intra-site variability, as we know in sites such as Notar Chirico and Cavani del Arago, wherein we have layers without bifaces, with sandwich between layers with bifaces, is one kind of variability. And sites such as both Isernia and Madhya Pipia, wherein in the region you have mode 2, but in that specific site you don't have a distinct mode 2 element space. I mean, it compares, I mean, yes, mode 2 techno complexes range all over Eurasia and Africa, so that's a lot of space and time which covers, so that also would lead to some kind of variability which needs to be addressed. And in terms of function, we know with regards to the function and hierarchy of the sites, the kind of tool assemblages would vary. So we also need to look at the functional hierarchy of the site before ascribing technological variability. And once we can negate all of this, there's also the what if of cultural variability, which is difficult to quantify but might have played a role. So that's why we need to consider and expand various criterion, including behavior and also site formation, because that would bias the assemblage itself. In the case of South Asia, unfortunately, site formation process is not exploited or used primarily. So that's something that we need to address. And we need to revisit previous collections because times change, paradigms change, and we need to update. And in the case of Madhya Pipria, we are currently working on a project to get a more reliable data set from primary collections and also excavations, and then we'll know for sure if it is mode 2 or not. I'd like to thank everybody who's here and all of the people on the slide for giving me access, and the institution for giving me access to the lithic assemblages. And thank you.